conducted the 750th memorial last year. So our teaching actually goes many, many hundreds of years further back. Catholic or Christian church is laid out, where the church itself is very long, and then also the ceiling is very high. So it gives you this feeling, naturally you look in this way, and because the ceiling is high, you look up this way, and you see this huge stained glass. Well, their focus for Christianity is to make one feel closer to God, and so it's this uprising feeling. Buddhism is different. All temples are basically laid out in this horizontal fashion, this way, because the focus for Buddhism is not this rising feeling, but rather it's to make you feel more grounded. The basic tenet of Buddhism is awareness about this right now, the present, this very moment. Okay? And so that way, when you look at the layout of the interior of the temple here, naturally you're, because of how it's laid out, you don't look up this way, but rather you look from side to side, this breadth. For instance, if you've been to any large national park in the United States, of course, the Grand Canyon, the scenery is breathtaking because one, you look at it this way, wow, it spreads out this way. So from the Buddha's time, that's what he told, is that may the teaching spread out across the land, so that all beings, all people are able to encounter and come to understand the significance of life. And so that feeling has been taken in to the layout of the architecture of Buddhist temples. For us in Jodo Shinshu, we are a Pure Land school. And so the altar in Japanese, the Naiji, represents what we feel the Pure Land or the Buddha Land looks like. Our school of Buddhism is different from maybe some other temples that you visited in that this seating area is much more broad because we invite people to come listen and participate in Buddhist talks and lectures. Whereas some other Buddhist schools, the altar area is very large with just a small walkway surrounding the altar so that very few people can attend. So for us, our focus is different. We want to invite people to the temple. That's why it's very spacious in this aspect. Now this building you're standing in was erected in 1760. When Hongwanji moved here or relocated here, Hongwanji has a kind of a long and complicated history because it was persecuted by the other sects of Buddhism. Shinran Shonin, our founder, felt that Buddhism should be for all people as Shakyamuni Buddha intended. Shakyamuni preached to all people from all walks of life in India. If you've ever been to Central Asia, some places are very, very poor. And so the Buddha felt that the teaching should be especially for those people whose lives are very difficult. Not for the ones who've very rich and very padded life, but rather for those who are barely able to get by. And so the Buddha preached to all people. So Shinran felt here in Japan as well, it should not be just for the elite or for the imperial class, but it should be for especially those whose lives, they're the farmers, the regular common people. Well, the other schools of Buddhism, because of how society was, and also in how society was in China, everyone had to pay taxes to the upper, the military, the warrior class, and then also to the elite class, the nobles. Well, the other schools of Buddhism did not want something that could cause disruption into society. Shinran, that was not his intent. Rather, that he wanted to provide comfort and solace to the common people. The other schools of Buddhism kept wanting to put down Shinran's teaching, and so our headquarters, our head temple, had to relocate many times throughout the central Japan area. Finally, in the mid-feudal period, during Toyotomi Hideyoshi's time, he was both positive and negative impact in Japanese history. We do realize he did commit many crimes in Asia, especially to the Korean Peninsula. But then, on the other hand, he was able to foster. He had many personal issues that he had to overcome. But it was through his bequeathing this property to Hongwanji that Hongwanji was able to return to this parcel of land. At that time, we will go into it next. The next hall was created at that time, in the early 1600s, and it survived from that period. I'm not sure if you're aware, are standing on a UNESCO World Heritage. It's because of the contribution that Buddhism, especially Jodo Shinshu, has made to Japanese society that it received this designation in 1994. But anyway, this building is over 260 years old. It underwent a thorough refurbishing, and because this is an active temple, the funding was by the membership here. So the Hongwanji has over 10,000 temples here in Japan, and also including those overseas. Where I'm from, on the continental US, we have about 65 temples. The state of Hawaii, when Hongwanji went there at that time, it was the Kingdom of Hawaii, has some 32 or 33 temples. Why don't we go to the front? Actually, let's wait because there are other folks visiting. The image in the center altar here is of Amida Buddha, the Buddha of immeasurable light and immeasurable life. In Sanskrit, he is referred to as Amitabha or Amitayus. The Buddha takes a sort of humanoid form here, but actually this is so that we people can understand when you talk about immeasurable life, immeasurable light. I studied biology when I was in university, and so we all talk about life, but when you have to actually describe it in your own words, it's actually formless and colorless and shapeless. But when you have to talk about it, you have to give it a shape, you have to give it a form so that other people can understand. The same with light. We know what light is. How many of you study physics? Physics is fascinating, except when you have to take a test. So we know what light is. Why do we know what light is? It's because we know what darkness is. When you have the two to contrast each other, then it's easier to understand. But darkness does not explain what light is either. Death does not explain what life is, but because both stand side by side. Both are important in order to understand the other. That's what Buddhism's aspect or understanding is. So anyway, the central altar has a standing image of Amida. You may go to other temples and often see a seated Buddha image. Well, that's throughout most of Japan and most of Asia. But here, we feel that the Buddha's activity is just that. It's very active. It's very positive thinking. And so the Buddha has a standing form here. We give this the story that if someone is seated, it takes more time and more effort for someone to get up and actually begin moving. In scientific terms, it's that power of inertia that has to be overcome. Just standing still, if you have a set wheel, it takes more energy to get that rolling. Whereas with a standing image, all it takes is just one step forward and already you're in motion. The other thing, some people often ask, why is everything covered in gold? Well, gold is the only element that's found in nature that never tarnishes. And so for us, it represents what the Buddha's teaching is. We may forget about it. It may, just like a precious ring or jewelry, be put away. But when it's rediscovered again, it's shining just as the day as it was created. So that's why most of our members here, as you can see, are regular people. They donate to the temple, make what we call in Buddhism, dana, selfless offerings, so that other people may also encounter this teaching. In our tradition, which follows from Asia, of course, we have different scrolls hanging in our altar here. We do not pray to them. Rather, they, for us, are reminders that we are indebted to others who have also passed down this teaching so that we may encounter it. It's a slightly different thinking than in mainland China, where they merely worship the ancestors. But for us, how many of you carry pictures in your phone? Yeah? Oh, come on, I think everyone does. Why do you have pictures? Why do you want to carry these pictures with you? Because they're important to you. These people are important to you. And so they're reminders. We don't carry them so that please help me with this. But rather, we feel very close to them. and we want to continue to feel close to them. It's the same way with these different images here. There are different masters from India, China, and Japan who, through their efforts, have enabled others, many others, to understand the Buddha's teaching. The last part I want to give to you is the artwork that you see here, and then we're going into also the castle chambers that we use here at Hongwanji. These are all from that medieval period. They are originals from either the mid-1600s or early 1700s. They are from the Kano school of Japanese painting. So if any of you have studied Japanese painting, a lot of people have come here and asked to actually see these originals and see how they've evolved, not evolved, but how they've weathered over time. Because they are in the same setting. They are used every day. These doors are open and closed just as they were hundreds of years ago. I guess that's it. Anything besides that would be a bit much, but just to give you an idea of size, the most Japanese rooms are measured by the number of tatami mats, and this tatami mat is basically a standard that's followed here. There's a slight difference between this Edo tatami and Kyoto tatami, but it's very small. Naturally, in measurement terms, it's about 3 feet by 6 feet, okay, roughly. Actually, 90 centimeters by 180 centimeters. But comfortably, 3 people can sit here. But during our large services, we have many, many people who come here. So everyone sits Japanese style, of course. If you want to try to do that, we'll do that next door. So when there are a lot of people, we ask them to keep their belongings on their laps. So if everyone crowds on here, about 8 or 9 people can sit on one tatami mat, shoulder to shoulder. So I let you do the calculation. About 8 or 9 people, there are about 800 tatami mats here. So you can get an idea of how many people can crowd in here. Next door, in the Goedo, our founder's hall, there are over 1,000 tatami mats there. So, if you're a little bit weak on math, I'll let you use your cell phone there. Okay? All right. Why don't we go to the front so you can get a closer view. Similar to that of China and of Southeast Asia. However, each area, if you look at places in Thailand, Cambodia, Myanmar, the roof line extends up even more, even that of Korea. So each area let this architecture evolve. However, the starting point was from Central Asia. And so you see on the pillars here, the artwork that's been painted. Actually, if you think about it, if you've seen movies about the bazaars, the large halls in India and Central Asia, these banners and flags were hung each time they had a festival or a special occasion, when the king visited or when eminent priests gave talks. Well, because temples are where these dharma talks or talks on the Buddha are given, they became painted on these pillars. You may sit comfortably if you want. You can't sit Japanese style for too long, but I won't go on very long. Those of you who are not familiar with etiquette in temples, we just, however, ask that you do not put your feet out forward this way. I think it's a common courtesy in all of Asia that we don't point our feet towards others, or we don't touch others with our feet, because our feet touch the ground and it's considered unclean. So if you do have to sit, can't sit Japanese style, please sit either cross-legged or with your legs to the side. You can also see here, different elements were picked up as Buddhism traversed the Asian continent. So we have this palace-like structure that the Buddha is enshrined in. It's from the Tang Dynasty of China. The hanging lamps are evolved creations from India. The wind chime-like things that you can sort of see hanging from the eaves of the palace in there. They are body ornaments, jewelry that the nobles in India wore. The reason we retain that particular element is because the Buddha said, one is not born into nobility, but rather one becomes noble through one's actions, through one's conduct. So everyone can become a noble person. Okay. If you'd like to take any pictures here, you may. Otherwise, we'll leave. You take a step back. This is another symbolic aspect of Buddhism. Sometimes when you become too involved in something, you don't see the entire picture, and you only keep your own viewpoint. So it's often referred to in our sutras for everyone to step out of yourself and step back. View things as if you were a third person looking at the situation rather than a directly involved person. Then step back into it, and it gives you a better perspective, a different perspective that sometimes helps you to see things as they really are rather than how you're inside your intention wants it to be. So as you can see here, it's much wider and actually much more broad than next door. Up above, the architecture is slightly different because the building next door was created about 150 years after this one was built. And so even in Japan at that time, just like Western buildings as well, new technology comes in, and so the building construction changes slightly. Translation of that is honorific. A is shadow, but it refers to the image. So it's the hall that enshrines the image of our founder Shinran Shonin. It's the lacquer statue that's in the center there. It's a life-size statue, but because everything else that surrounds it is so large, it's kind of hard to tell. But it's actually about my height, seated. Of there. The reason we have this here again is because this hall is where we listen to talks that or discourses that explain about Shinran's teaching of the pure life. Now, Amida, as we view it, those of you who have studied Buddhism or maybe who are a little bit aware of the intention of Buddhism, Buddha actually means enlightened being, enlightened one. So it's one who is awakened to the truth of ultimate reality. And all these terms, okay, but then if you have to actually, what is ultimate reality? Well, that's been a question that's been around since the start of human civilization. Each culture, each civilization has its own way of explaining what this ultimate reality is. And so for Buddhism, it becomes this understanding of what an enlightened being is. People sometimes misconstrue what this word of enlightenment is. It's awakening, awareness for us, but it's not awareness of what other people are thinking. In the 70s and 80s, this was often corrupted into, well, you become a mind reader. No, Buddhism's focus is not that. That's what someone wants it to be. Rather, this awakening is awakening of one's own self, one's own life. What is the meaning of life? What is the meaning of this existence here? And so the awakening is one's awakening into what I actually am. A human, what does it mean to be a human being? And So this is why we praise the image of the Buddha that Shinran has selected, designated as the source of all life. Once again, just about the building here. Shinshu is, some people say, it's too easy because we emphasize that all one needs to do is to intone or to say, Namo Amida Butsu, I take refuge in the Buddha of immeasurable life. But it's been abbreviated so that all people, being able to repeat something over and over. For instance, in our regular world, I have three little children. And so, because they don't know, they should be appreciative of different things. As parents, we often are, and even myself growing up, our parents are, say thank you. Tell them thank you. And so you hope, through that, your children begin to learn what it means to be thankful for something. Because naturally, children don't know. So you give them guidance into trying to become thankful. In the same way, by saying Namo Amida Butsu is to appreciate, become appreciative and aware of what life is. And it encompasses all these different things of not being wasted. Don't waste your life. So don't sacrifice. Don't give up on your life. All these different items that come into play as we grow up. Now, again, once again, as you can see, about six or seven of you are able to sit like this on one tatami mat. So on large services, there's close to 4,000 or 5,000 people in this building. Yes, it's a bit cold because here and there we have the doors that are open, but actually it's much colder outside. The way this building has been constructed, it's something that through generations of trial and error in Asia as well, in the summertime, it's blistering hot outside. But you come in here, there's always a gentle breeze that's going through. So this becomes another, what we say, sort of an oasis or a vihara in Buddhist Japanese. It becomes a place of refuge. So the place of refuge is one not only for the body, but also for the mind and the spirit. So that vihara is something that we carry through as far as we call it in Western terms, hospice. So it's the end of life care as well. Because maybe at this age, religion, okay, yeah, I know, I was the same way. You understand it because that's what our family does, but I really don't know the significance of it right now. But as you grow older, especially those who are closer to this other end, sort of the closure of the circle, you begin wondering even more, what was the whole meaning of everything in life? What can I leave behind for those that I'm related to? So it's your opportunity now to begin thinking about that, especially as university students, especially as those who come from a different background or a different culture or come from a different society, to see how others throughout the world are also thinking. In Japanese Buddhism especially, as you can see, the white item there in the front sort of looks like a large ice cream cone or ice cream sundae. It's an offering of rice. So for Buddhism, or Japanese Buddhism, we offer this rice because rice in Asia, as you know, is a staple. It becomes our mainstays in our diet. But there's another significance behind it. In the West, where I'm from, some people have said, well, in Japanese, this is called bukban. Bu is for Buddha. Pan is han, or this rice. But it sounds like in English, pan, bread. Can't we offer bread instead as an offering? Well, yeah, that's okay, because it becomes a food that's shared with everyone. However, this offering of rice has a deeper, more profound meaning to it. When you cut a loaf of bread, well, once it's cut, then the amount that can be passed around to everyone is pretty limited, right? How many of you like kanji? How do you make kanji?
Kanji?
In Japanese it's called okai, okayu.
Oh. How do you make it? You boil cooked rice, right? Well, if more people come, you bring your friends over. Oh, there's, okay, we'll just put more water in it. Put a few more vegetables in it. You can expand it so that everyone can take part in it. And it's the same way with this, as far as for Buddhism. We share this. Of course, it's an offering. After it's been offered, we take it down. In Japanese, it's osagari. It's not just hand-me-down, but rather it's to be shared equally among everyone. Well, you intended it first for maybe this group here, about 20? Not quite 20. But then a few more come in. Well, we'll just put a little bit more water and put a few vegetables in. Well, then it can accommodate even more people. And so that's through this explanation that our members overseas realize as well, I guess we should go with the traditional route, offering rice instead, because then everyone can take part. And that was also the underlying sort of thinking, even for the after the earthquake in northern Japan. It's different than in the West, and this became noticed by many Western journalists. After the hurricane in Louisiana, it's a phenomenon that seems to be outside of Asia, especially outside of Japan, with fighting. Everyone tries to take as much as they can just for their own family. But for the people who encountered the tsunami and the earthquake in Tohoku, everyone lined up quietly, and for just one rice ball, for one cup of miso shiru. Oh, thank you. Don't you want more? No, there's more people that need to be fed. This is enough for me. The idea, the underlying idea, I believe in Buddhism, is just like the Nishi. It should be shared equally. I have enough. I don't need all this, because other people also need it. So it's an idea that we hope that other people, you as well, maybe subtly influenced by this. Do I really need all of this stuff that my self-centered interest? Yes, I want it all. But actually, do I really need it? Join the chambers here at Hongwanji. They are actual castle chambers that were donated to us when Hongwanji relocated here. There are many stories as to how Hongwanji came to acquire them, but the generally accepted one is that it was a gift from Toyotomi Hideyoshi. The story goes that these chambers were actually assembled at his castle in Fushimi. The castle itself is gone, but there's a barrel concrete replica that's still there. It used to be a yuenchi, or an amusement park. But the amusement park is gone now, it's just a park now. But they left the castle there to show where it was. Now, these chambers, according to our own records, came here around the late or mid 1600s, after the Goedo was built. These panels in here, however, are new. They have been put here to protect the originals that are just behind them. Originally, this was not covered with a roof because this was an outside waiting room to go into the chambers. Somewhere after, or the mid 1700s sometime, this roof was added to this. So for over 100 years, these panels were exposed to the outside elements, and so they became very weathered. For the 750th that we completed earlier this year, these panels were created so people, guests, could see what they looked like previously. These chambers were created in China. It was the end of the Ming Dynasty or early Qing Dynasty. So this kind of high culture that was brought in from China was very highly upheld here in Japan. So during this period, there are some other temples and smaller castles throughout Japan that have the same motif, because it was through Hideyoshi's urging, actually it was his own kind of interested hobby, that he liked the culture from China and from Korea.
So in one sense, he wanted the Japanese to also be able to enjoy this. That's why, as the Japanese interpret it, I've read both sides, but as the Japanese interpreted, Hideyoshi wanted the Japanese to also encounter them. So he beckoned artisans from China and from Korea to come to Japan and to teach, expose the Japanese to this culture. Well, of course, those artisans, after so many years, wanted to go home. Well, Hideyoshi didn't want them to leave because then that would end that sharing of that culture. And so he didn't allow them to leave. Well, some escaped. And so what he did then, of course, as everyone else knows, went into China and forcibly brought more over. So it became this known as forced labor that he initiated. But according to what I've read here, he asked them to come. And of course they did come, but one's own self-centeredness, you want them to always stay here. But of course people have their own lives that they want to lead. So anyway, this is called the Chamber of Tigers. They take this cat-like pose because, as you know, tigers are not found here in Japan. And so the artisans did the next best thing by copying cats that posed this way. The tiger skins were imported from China, but as you can see, the tigers all have this kind of bug-eyed look to them because they were, the tigers themselves were already dead. So likely, he had the artisans had their apprentices pose with these tiger skins over them. That's why they had these huge, broad shoulders like that. Buff cat like this. So, like this one over here. Performers come to give a performance for the visiting guests. The large roof that you see on top is of cypress bark. This was the type of roof which was popular during the feudal period. That closeness to nature can be seen through this. However, because it was during the Warring States period, it was also very easily set afire. All it took was one flaming arrow. And so it was during that time that roofs changed from this cypress bark to, as you know, the more commonly used clay tiles. That was also one other reason why Hideyoshi wanted the Korean artisans to come to teach how these resilient clay tiles could be made. That technology was not in Japan at that time. Koke no niwa. It's a Japanese rendition of a Chinese style garden. Here again, this was during that medieval period where Chinese culture was upheld very highly. And so this utilizes those techniques that are often used in Chinese-style gardens, that being of this dry landscape. Here, huge boulders and rocks. This has been purposely uplifted this way to create this mountain scenery that's found in China. According to the placard there, depending on how you read it, Mount Ro or Mount Lu is where a Buddhist monastery was located. And so, in this mountainous area, the items in the background, the backdrop, have been incorporated. So the roofline of the Goedo here represents that huge peak amidst this mountain range. Now over time, people have donated or brought back plants that are not naturally found here in Japan. Very Japanese style, trying to take care of them. And so this is to keep the cold out, but also too, insects burrow themselves into the tree trunks and also the limbs. These are actually sago palms. Mm-hmm. And so they cover it this way so that the insects bury themselves into the rice straw here. Mm-hmm. Actually, I think there was a little bit of frost this morning. And so it's also to keep the cold off of the tender shoots that will come out next year. Since this is a Chinese style of garden, there are other symbolic animals that are also found here. If you let your mind kind of wander, this is kind of a contemplation or a meditation garden. So this island here, what does it look like? Mm-hmm. A turtle. Ah. This is the greenback here. The head is hanging out there. The one behind it What does that formation look like?
Cactus.
Cactus?
Cactus?
Oh. A symbolic animal in China.
Dragon.
A dragon. It's a resting dragon. The head is down there. You can see it sort of looks like the eye is closed with the snout. The claw is there. And so the sago palms have been put in there to look like the back. The back side. This one's a bit harder to, depends on how you're, where you're standing to look at it here. This formation here, this kind of sticks out, so you did it very well. It's supposedly a stork or a crane. Bridges here represent the two wings of the stork. This is the head here, and the feet go off that way. Kind of hard to see from here, you have to sort of stand. There's no electrical lights in here. So it's all through filtered light. So this technique too was introduced from China, in that gold and white, the white of the paper, has been used to reflect this light back and forth. And so you have a very subtle filtered light that comes in here. However, in Japan it evolved even more, where these panels were paper, layer and layer upon washi or Japanese paper with gold leaf and then a sheer layer of silk upon which these paintings were done. And since, as you know, Asian paper, especially Japanese paper, is basically acid-free, 400 years have elapsed. But as you know, paper tears after a while, so it's been repaired. However, the artisan at that time ingeniously decided to paint these wisteria vines here because you can conceal where the rips and the tears are. The repairs have been made. But if you look carefully, you can see, oh, I guess that is a tear. Up above, because these are castle chambers, anywhere that could be decorated was decorated. And so he used this his own idea to create this motif of books and scrolls, because these scrolls became the key to learning, which was also the key to power. But also paper, as you know, becomes nesting material for mice. And so he decided, very subtle humor, yes. He painted a cat in the center panel there. Thinking that it would keep away the mice. Okay. One other thing I want to point out. If you've seen temples and castles in China, the focus there is everything is symmetrical. I've been to the Forbidden City, the layout of it, the two towers, it can be divided this way, and it's a mirror image of each other. However, the Japanese feel that nothing in nature is completely symmetrical. So that's why that architecture was brought here to Japan, but it evolved a bit. This hallway that we're standing in, if you take a look around, it seems like it could be symmetrical. But if you look carefully, the height of the doors is different. Okay, and even if you were to divide it in the center there, where that central panel is, this portion juts out, so it's not symmetrical. It's always a bit asymmetrical. The idea being, and I did this in school when I was in university, you take a photograph of your face and you cut it in half, put a mirror to it to reflect the other side. It seems like it's your face, but it's not, because even your face is not completely symmetrical. Chamber, there's everywhere you go, especially in California, have to be at least a certain width, certain height, and certain breadth. So this is for the benefit of those who cannot see very well. So you walk and you can climb stairs with your eyes closed because you know how high the stairs are. Here it's different because it's purposely different. When people stormed each other's castle, if you don't know the height, if it's purposely a bit too high or a bit too low, you stumble and fall if you're running through. I think if you've walked around in the old sections of Japan, It's like, oh, why is that step so high? You catch yourself, but there's an extra step that's only this high, and you catch your toe on it. So that's why all those things in California had to be done away with. But it was a strategy here because, you know, it was a way of keeping people out or allowing others to escape. You know your own home, where it's a little bit low or a little bit high or it's a little bit wobbly or whatever, but others don't. This is the North No Stage. The significance of this is the oldest outdoor No Stage in Japan. And so we do still upkeep it, but the unique feature about this, within this limited space, there are a number of illusions that are created. Some of them have been attributed to Hideyoshi, but then also to other, of course, carpenters and craftsmen. If you notice the other stage, this walkway, this hanamichi, is perpendicular to the stage, but here it's at a diagonal. It's covered up right now because of the seasons, but this hand railing here is different than the one that was surrounding the temple hall, because this one here is only about this high. Likewise, the walkway itself, if you look carefully, the hand railing there is bowed. So it's creating sort of a forced perspective, a forced disappearing spot in the back. The covering the walkway up above, it's not straight across this way, but actually on the far end, it's down this way, it's at a diagonal again. So it's trying to make that area look much further away than it actually is. And likewise, the door at that end, it's only this high. So, actors coming in appear to be very huge. Okay, and so it's trying to make total use of this space here. One other thing is, outside here, if you have an inner court anywhere, maybe it's your own university or whatever, but it's surrounded on walls, usually on three sides, there's sort of an echo that occurs. Well, there's no echo out here, and they feel that the reason for that are these stones that are here. Same as the rock garden in the other open court there. It's to serve as a sort of soundproofing. At first glance, these rocks seem to be just thrown out here haphazardly, but by looking carefully, you see that they're all about this kind of oblong shape. And basically, they're all laid out in this vertical fashion. So it serves as a soundproofing that allows the sound to travel back and forth this way, not just round and around. Up above and around into castles at that time. It's a formal meeting room, or formal audience room. In fact, when we've had honored guests who've come to Hongwanji, in the past, while I've been here, the NASA astronauts, former Senator John Glenn, and the Dalai Lama as well. Our Monshu, our head priest here, who is a direct descendant of Shinran, entertained them in these chambers. Now, in the castle, the tassel doorways across the way would have been an entrance to a bedroom or sleeping chamber, but they say Hideyoshi used them as places to keep his own bodyguards in waiting. Likewise, the painting in the back there, you have to take a look at it from the side here, but this also uses a reverse perspective. Hideyoshi was not very tall. He was only about less than 5 feet. Sorry, any of you in 5 feet. But he had to give this awe of power. And so that's why, if you've seen in museums, his armory, it tries to make him look very, very big. And so likewise, here too, the raised dais here is double the normal height. And then also the tatami mats. This serves as another purpose to create an illusion that the rooms are much longer than they actually are. So when he's seated there, guests who enter from the far end makes them feel that he is this really large man. Can someone please close that door created into castles at that time? It's a formal meeting room or formal audience room. In fact, when we've had honored guests who've come to Hongwanji,
In the past, while I've been here, the NASA astronauts, former Senator John Glenn, and the Dalai Lama as well, our Monshu, our head priest here, who is a direct descendant of Shinran, entertained them in these chambers. Now, in the castle, the tassel doorways across the way would have been an entrance to a bedroom or sleeping chamber, but they say Hideyoshi used them as places to keep his own bodyguards in waiting. Likewise, the painting in the back there, you have to take a look at it from the side here, but this also uses a reverse perspective. Hideyoshi was not very tall. He was only about less than 5 feet. Sorry, any of you are 5 feet. But he had to give this awe of power. And so that's why if you've seen in museums, his armory, it tries to make him look very, very big. And so likewise, here too, the raised dais here is double the normal height. And then also the tatami mats. This serves as another purpose to create an illusion that the rooms are much longer than they actually are. So when he's seated there, guests who enter from the far end makes them feel that he is this really large man.
Can someone please close that door for me?
For the samurai moves, the jidaigeki. So maybe you've seen this particular room before. There's another step down. People do out here. Hideyoshi always wanted to sit in his seat, his designated seat, on the dais there. There's a reason for that, because when you take a step back and look at everything, you're able to see things that people up close cannot. Okay? So step back into it this way as you're looking at the back, and you'll be able to see something. Larger than life. So, sitting out there on the veranda, you're not able to see the pine tree, but from back here, you are. This is the main audience chamber. And this is where Hideyoshi had a guest with other regular visiting guests and vassals. Now, this room too, just like the others, has illusions that are created through the architecture. Here, I'll point you out very carefully because I know you're running out of time. But the space between the pillars here from the back are 2 tatami mats long. But after this wooden break, it becomes 1.5. So view from back here makes this room look longer than it actually is. When in fact, it's a square room. So this, all of this makes it look longer. Coming up here. This is the culmination of the panels that we saw. It's of a pilgrimage to the capital to visit the new emperor. So, once again, the tassel doorways there. This is called Konoma, or the Chamber of Storks. The Chinese characters are a bit more specific than English is. Storks, cranes, well, this is actually a type of stork, not a crane. Konotori, actually, in Japanese. So once again, the raised dais, when it was important for the emperor, the empress, or the imperial family to be present, they sat on this Jojo no ma, or this higher raised dais. The bamboo blinds here had been left because even some court officials were not allowed to see the imperial family face to face. So these were lowered. But for us as in Buddhism, this is also used, as you saw in our main hall. It's to somewhat conceal, I don't know what word is appropriate in English here, but as a courtesy to the Buddha, because we in our regular world do different things which to some people could be taken as being rude. So when people sit there and it's not a religious type of service, the blinds are sometimes lowered. So it is out of a courtesy. It's just like pulling down your blinds at night or closing your curtains. So anyway.